Right then. Good evening and thank you all for joining our live panel discussion on Changing Classrooms India here on Teams. And a special good morning and a special thank you to Mark, who has been kind enough to wake up in the morning and in fact the very early hours in the morning at about 4:30 a.m. in Seattle to join our discussion. We appreciate and value the time of and enthusiasm and in fact the whole interest that everybody has shown, and especially our panelists who've been kind enough to be on our panel today, to be a part of this discussion and showcase their thoughts and joined us today for this conversation. So I begin this session by thanking you all. And just as we begin, I just want to familiarize everyone with the platform that we are using today. This is Microsoft Teams as we use today. This channel is being used for having this discussion live here on Teams, where we have select few MI experts from across India who have joined us in Teams and will be joining us as we move forward. And they will be talking to us using the comment box only. We have our esteemed panelists with us to whom I will be presenting thoughts, and they will be deliberating on that thoughts and sharing through their rich experience what they think about that particular thought or that particular question or query. Also, we have a parallel Twitter discussion going on, which is being hosted by Jyoti Chhaba and being moderated by Pooja Sachdeva. All of us are a member of the team Deep Pedagogics. Duhita Parmar today is moderating the session here with me today. Deep Pedagogics, as most of you know, has been into the field of education over the last 4 years, and we have been working as learning partners with Microsoft and now also with Adobe to bring you the best in education technology. With that, I want to also set the stage by telling you that this live panel discussion is a concluding event marking a week-long discussion on Changing Classrooms India, where educators have been sharing their thoughts on Twitter. Well, the aim of this Mindshare session is to exchange thoughts around the way education has transformed in Indian classrooms and inspire more and more educators to be increasingly aware, informed and motivated towards embracing this change. So our panelists have been watching the tweets and we've shared the consolidation with them prior to this session to give them a glimpse of this conversation. Participants here and on Twitter will get a chance to interact with our esteemed speakers and professionals from education sector and voice their thoughts, queries and worries. Let me begin by introducing our panelists. Max Pavel is a global award-winning educator and principal who is currently the education leader from Microsoft Worldwide based in Seattle, USA. Max's interests include future-ready skills and emotional intelligence. Max holds a Bachelor's of Education and Master's in Education Leadership Management with a focus on online communities of professional practices. You can follow him on Twitter at Sparvel. S-P-A-R-V-E-L-L. I'm going to put that in the chat box. Mark, would you like to say hello there?
Yep. Good morning, everybody from Washington State in the USA. Delighted to be part of this conversation with this very esteemed panel.
Thank you. Dr. Vinnie Jory is with us. She is the Director of Education Advocacy at Microsoft Corporation India Limited. She's responsible for evangelizing education initiatives at Microsoft. She leads and manages strategic engagements like higher education and K-12 and also works on policy issues related with education. The work spans, well, I don't think there'll be enough time for me to really introduce her correctly because she has loads that of credits that she carries with her. But her work spans are around programmatically managing professional development, curriculum development, certifications, explorations around gamification of education. And her contributions have won her recognition across several Microsofts, such as the Gregor Butler Award and the Worldwide Team of the Year 2014, Award for Compliance and Business Contribution 15-16, the Greenest Subsidiary for Evangelism Recognition 16-17, Brand Evangelist Award from Public Sector 2016-17. Wow. Winnie, ma'am, could you please say a hello to everyone?
Good evening and good morning. It's really a privilege to be a part of this panel and look forward to the rich interactions with all of you.
Thank you. A passionate educator who believes that it is only through education that India's destiny can change, Mrs. Amrita Burman has been associated with Sunbeam for over 25 years now. She has really rich experience and has been a pivot around whom the Sunbeam Percept, who has built and closely monitors the unpacking of Percept across 24 Sunbeam schools. She has traveled widely both in India and abroad and is in complete sync with happenings in the field of education and all around, and I vouch for that. She is also a part of the AFS think tank besides being ahead of the Round Square Sunbeam. She was a part of FICCI delegation, which visited in London in February 2019 to attend Learn It and attended Microsoft Worldwide Education Conference E2 in Paris this year. Mrs. Burman, if you could please say hello there.
Hello to everyone. It's really a pleasure to be a part of this very, very esteemed panel. And I think I'm really happy, besides everyone else, to have a student with us, because I think their perspective is so important. So Padam, especially to you, I'm glad to be sharing this panel with you. Thank you.
I will be the briefest while introducing Padam there. But before I introduce Padam, I have Dr. Ashish Mittal, who holds a doctorate degree in education and two master's degree in mathematics and philosophy. He also has obtained M.Ed. from CCS University. Another feather in the cap in his academic accomplishments is his achievement of the award-qualifying National Eligibility Test of UGC NET in the first attempt in 2011. He has been selected as a mentor for change under the project of AIM by Niti Aayog. His contribution is also recognized as a trainer by STEM Kit, and he's heading the entire functioning of academics and examination of senior secondary and secondary associated with Indrapuram group of institutions across the country since long, along with being the deputy head of institutions of a good repute. Dr. Ashish Mittal, please.
Hello, everyone. It's my really a privilege to be the panel member of such a wonderful, and we have a student, as Ma'am Burman has already mentioned, that we have a student, very enthusiastic student, who has consented always to be the part of such discussions. So this is always my privilege to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. And last but not the least, and I feel I always had it on my mind to have a 360 degree view, though a parent is missing, but I guess most of us are parents here, so we could view our thoughts as parents as well as educationists. So I will welcome Padam Chopra and thank him for being here. He's a world finalist in Microsoft Imagine Cup 2018, second runner-up and the best and the best accessibility project at Indian Nationals. Went to Seattle, the US, on a week-long sponsorship trip by Microsoft to represent his project at the World Finals in 2018. Padam, floor is all yours.
Hello, everyone. I'm really excited to be a part of this panel and to discuss my views on the topic we are discussing today.
Thank you, Padam. And here I throw open the first thought that we have, the whole idea behind this discussion. Education in Indian classrooms is changing. Is it true? And if yes, how far? I think we're going to begin with Amrita, ma'am, so that you know she can share her thoughts with us.
Yes, positively, things have changed tremendously. As it was mentioned earlier, it's been 25 years that I've been, in a place like Varanasi, which is obviously not a metropolitan city. In fact, it's a two-tier town of a very backward state like Uttar Pradesh in India. And I think things have changed so much. I think a few reasons for this is technology has brought the whole world so much close to each other. Anything happening in any other part of the world has now come into the classroom, even in a place like Varanasi. So children's perspective has changed. Parents' perspective has changed. And this has forced a teacher and any educator's perspective to change. So one of the main reasons is awareness, of which I think technology has a huge, huge role to play. So yes, things have changed and changed tremendously over the years.
Fantastic. I think I'm going to leave the floor open for any of our panelists to join in this conversation.
May I interrupt, please?
Go ahead. Please share your thoughts.
Yes, I totally agree with Madam Burman. What she has mentioned, that things have already been changed and are changing as well. So yes, that is a big fact, that it was a time where the classrooms were confined to only textbooks and the blackboards. Rather, the recent revolution towards the classroom we see today has changed the view of learning of the child. Today's classrooms are not only furnished with different and various tools of education, but yes, it is about the relationship building between the parents and the teachers to amplify the holistic development of a child from a very early age. Today's education system has been advanced for the emotional, for the physical, for the psychological well-being of the child. But yes, we always can say that now in this age, now in today's era, information is readily available at our fingertips. Today's classrooms are inclined more in providing with unique hands-on experiences rather than following the traditional way of teaching, what we had been following in the past years, such as if I talk about myself, that we have started using the different manipulatives to teach mathematics in our classes, different blocks, etc., to teach the concepts of the 3D geometry. But yes, if I do remember, if I do recall my timing when I was a student, I used to study about the three-dimensional geometry just to see on the boards. We had to just imagine what is 3D shapes. But now we have different manipulatives, different systems, different technologies to show, to have the hands-on learning experiences to the students. So things are tremendously changing. That I do agree with Madam Burman, what she has mentioned. If we compare it from the early age to now.
Great, thank you. Is that okay for me to speak?
Absolutely.
Okay, so from my perspective, when I think about India, I've been judging innovative teaching and learning involving participants from India for probably close to a decade. Plus also each year I judge the Global Enterprise Challenge, which focuses on student entrepreneurships. So my view over the years, what's shifted is this very positive change. This positive change towards a focus on learners and their learning, away from a focus on teachers and their teaching. And I see and hear this all of the time when I engage with educators from across India. I see this rise in a focus on global citizenship. So if you like, there's been this significant shift from being very inward focused to being very outward focused. A focus on what can we contribute as an individual, as a group, as a classroom, as a school and community, what can we can contribute back? And I see this evidence very strongly through the amazing work across Indian schools focused on sustainable development goals and activities in that space. Back to you.
Fantastic.
Yeah, may I add in now?
Absolutely.
So I just graduated high school about 2 months back, and as a student for the past 12 years, I've kind of experienced this change firsthand. When I was in fifth, as Dr. Ashish just said, that when we were learning about 3D shapes, the teacher used to sort of struggle with the tools that were available in the class to tell us about 3D shapes. She used to take the duster in one hand, books in the other, and pens. But now we have all sorts of tools in the software, in the computers. I've seen how ICT, we're using ICT, that is information and communication technology, more in classrooms these days. And then there's concepts like adaptive learning coming up, which basically means that students are sort of getting more personalized attention. So that, I believe, has sort of transformed what is happening in the classrooms these days.
Hearing from you, Padam, it really gives us much validation that the kind of effort that is being put in is phenomenal. I think I'll leave it for Dr. Vinny to share what is her experience been with the education scenario, since she's been working in this segment from inside and outside of the tech companies.
Thank you, Meenakshi. There's been a dramatic change in the way the classrooms are evolving in India, and it is very heartening to see the change and the progressive thinking, not only in the private schools, but also in the government space as well. So we have seen, as Mark shared, that there is a focus on the learner and the learning process, and it's getting towards preparing students for the future and driving skills such as critical thinking, collaboration, and teamwork. I would like to share some insights from the government, from the state schools across India. So in the state of Maharashtra, for example, we have one of our MIE expert educators, Ranjit Singh Desale, who's doing virtual field experiments for thousands and thousands of teachers on a weekly basis. And in a system where there are still challenges around internet or information access, the passionate teacher is trying to create distinct learning experiences for his students. And likewise in Tamil Nadu as well, we have teachers who are Zilla Parishad teachers, but developing and embracing technology in their own ways, creating learning experiences for learning languages. And in the private sector as well, Delhi government, for example, has is setting up model schools. They are imbibing technology and driving the happiness curriculum. In the private sector as well, we see a spectrum of schools that range from bringing their own device to embracing cloud and tinkering with technologies like Teams, Flipgrid, to create very unique learning experiences. And we see that, and it's the leadership aspect that has been that has played a key role in precipitating this change in the learning culture in the schools. And we have wonderful examples where the leadership led from the front in terms of driving this change, whether it's a school in Fagwara led by Mrs. Dhillon, or Amrita at Varanasi, or Aarti at the MIT group of schools. I think we have some very, very passionate leaders who are setting the stage for this change to happen in India.
Can I come in?
Sure,
okay.
Please.
So actually, I just want to take off. We started with technology. I just mentioned it. And obviously, rightly so, everybody mentioned technology. But what I also see a lot as a change in the classrooms because of technology, because of, you know, the world becoming smaller, is also attention spans becoming very short of the children. These are the challenges now that the teachers are facing in the classes. There is, you know, attention span. So you kind of don't know where you really have to keep doing a lot of things. Technology helps at times, but technology takes you away at times. So teachers keep asking this question, how much is too much? I mean, sometimes when there's too much of screen time or any other way, I'm also missing out on the personal touch. How do I do that? Children's emotional, you know, the touch that a child needs emotionally also tends to get a little taken away. So these are the kind of challenges that the teachers are facing of addiction to excessive technology, attention span not being there. Collaboration is met beautifully though with technology, like Vinny just mentioned about Skype. And I mean, my school is doing so much of Skype with all over the different schools in different parts of the world, which I think is great. But this also has its pitfalls. So that becomes, I think, a great challenge for a teacher today. The other thing which I think that the challenge that technology puts forward is, a lot of teachers themselves are not very comfortable with technology. So there, when they can't really connect very well, whereas next to you, there's a classroom where there's a younger teacher and she manages to connect beautifully. So, you know, that little balance between experience, a great experienced teacher failing with technology, the next room, there's a teacher very good with technology, but probably failing in experience. This leaves the leaders of the schools today in a little bit of a dilemma. So I thought we could kind of discuss this also a little more. What are the challenges we are facing with technology?
Meenakshi, I do agree with the statement what just given by Barun ma'am. So actually, we can say that technology, I also mentioned in my tweets also that we can say that technology is, it is like a curse also, but at times it is a boon also. So I give equal weightage at times to the teachers, because it is a teacher who can make a difference in the class, whether using the technology or without using the technology. So we can always say that technology, like we all are discussing over the topic over here, so this is just possible because of the technology. But in the classes, I don't give the 100% weightage to the technology to be more, to generate a curiosity in the class, to be more very kind of, we can say that kind of generating the interest in the class. So I don't give the kind of weightage to the technology only, because it is a teacher who can generate all these things. When we can say that we are talking about different type of skills to be generated, do you ever think that in the past times we also had a very, very good relationship with our teachers, but now we are teaching our children to develop those good relationship with the teachers. We are teaching the teachers also to develop the different type of and a good relationship with the peers, with other educators, with the maybe the school leaders. So why are we teaching it? Because there is a lack of it due to the technology of or other kind of system. So I do not I do not give a 100% credit or the weightage to the technology, that we have been tech savvy completely, but we are making our classes very beautiful just because of the technology. So technology is good, but technology is bad also at times. So it is we as a teacher who can make our classes very innovative, creative, and generate the interest in the students.
Yeah, I would completely agree with Dr. Ashish here. We know from our research in Microsoft that providing innovative devices does not produce innovative teaching and learning. And that was published in a piece of research in 2011, which was an extensive global study in innovative teaching and learning. What I've placed in the meeting chat are some research articles, and my advice for the teaching profession and school leaders is always, please go back to the research, go back to the extensive literature reviews coming from authoritative sources, which have got insights around the potential that technology has in the hands of skilled educators to do good. And a couple that I'll just call out, because I think they connect with what we just heard from the very wise Dr. Ashish here. One is the OECD just released their TALIS survey reports. The OECD is the Organization of Economic and Cooperative Development. They surveyed 500,000 teachers and school leaders across 50 countries. And very clearly there was a message around the need for greater upskilling and training when it came to the use of technology to support pedagogy. So that was certainly very clear from the teachers' voice themselves. I've shared in the chat a publication from UNICEF that you might want to look at, and I'll tweet this out in a moment too, published 2 years ago, which looked at, is there an impact on student mental health, well-being, and physical states as a result of screen time? What does the evidence and clinical research say about this? True or false? What should we be thinking about? So your teachers might like that. And the other one I've just popped, and I'll share that out on Twitter, is from the World Economic Forum, A New Vision for Education, an extensive literature review which looked at the promising role of technology in specifically supporting social and emotional skills. But to go back to Dr. Ashish's main point, which I completely agree with, providing innovative devices does not result in innovative teaching and learning. There needs to be an equal emphasis placed upon the skilling up of teachers. Back to you.
Thank you. As a host, I think I'm going to gather all these thoughts and bring to you. I do agree that, you know, technology has a role to play, but how far and how deep we are yet to measure. Yet, I would say technology is only one of the accelerators. Taking from what you said, Dr. Ashish, you said that, you know, we would connect with our teachers. So it's just you and me or one-on-one connections that we are talking about. What technology might have enabled, according to the kind of chats that are going on, is connections, building that connections between your classroom and other classrooms. Like Shailaja Dutt has tweeted that the very fact that learning is no longer confined to the classrooms explains the change. As educators, we are exploring different avenues through technology, offering a mixed platter of students to our students for global perspective. So I guess there are multiple elements, and the links which Mark has been very kind to share with us should bring in more perspective towards the same path. Moving forward, also, I would like to bring to your attention that our opening thought did not really say that there was technology playing a role. It just said education in Indian classrooms is changing. And you will naturally see, you know, technology being the front runner out there to take the credit. Therefore, we bring it down to a thought saying classroom learning environment has changed. So learning environment is much, much, much deeper, wider and bigger than just technology. So is it really true? And if yes, how far?
Yes, if I may express my thoughts here. Yes, the environment has definitely evolved with the onset of the fourth industrial revolution powered by digital technologies. There is a deep rethink both in K-12 and higher education on the need for driving innovation in thought process and also encouraging entrepreneurship as well and move away from the conventional rote learning. And in order to drive and spark the threads of innovation and entrepreneurship. So the government has also created multiple programs in their own ways to make students future ready. So definitely there is a shift in terms of thinking beyond the conventional curriculum, and Atal Tinkering Labs, for example, is a very refreshing initiative that is driving and creating environment for tinkering with technologies and not just do exam-oriented education, which we have conventionally been so used to. So there is this whole approach. I think we need, other than the speaker, we need to put the mic on mute, please. So we need to rethink about ways of imbibing design thinking skills, connecting with the industry, establishing connections with the problems around us, and encourage the students to think on their feet. And technology can be a part of that whole solution, but it's not necessary that it is the center stage. So it's a means to an end and not an end in itself.
Nakshi? Certainly, ma'am. Please go ahead.
So Sunanda? Actually, there's another very important change that I see in the classrooms of today. I did mention earlier about the demands that have been put in by the students these days. Their attention span is less and, you know, they're looking for different ways. Now, all this has forced the educators. They have no choice today. If you have to do a nice interactive classroom, if you need that kind of a classroom, you're forced to learn. You're forced to research on different ways of teaching and methods of teaching. So I think this demand that has been put on educators today, very subtly, by the child's learning styles, which are evolving, and you know, there needs to be all different ways in which they have to be kept busy, kept engaged, need to be, you know, a mind has to be active all the while. This has forced educators to learn. According to me, I see that as a very, very positive change in our classrooms. Everybody is being forced to learn, which I think used to be very stagnant earlier, what I used to see many years back. That's changed tremendously. So I think that's a great change. And technology, adopting technology has also been one of those changes in the classroom. A teacher has no choice today but to adopt a technology.
Totally agree. Kamalpreet has put it in our chat window beautifully, saying that the need that drives education has changed. Earlier, it was only knowledge focused to prepare students up for their, you know, assembly line industry. But now it's empowering students with 21st century skills for future roles. Padam, what's your take on this?
Yeah, so I believe that not only do the educators here need to sort of set a curriculum which does not focus much on technology, but even the learners need to get an idea of the right balance that they need to maintain. It's basically, it's up to the students themselves to get an idea of how much technology should be used and how much traditional textbook reading is required as well. Another thing that I believe is that one major change that's happening right now in education is that it's not only being imparted in the classroom, but outside as well. A sort of collaborative environment has come up wherein students are using tools, are using online chat rooms to go beyond that 6-hour period in the school and share education and share their knowledge with each other. There's a student who sort of compiled data from the class 12th and class 10th board examinations about 4 years ago. The author gave a TED talk that year, and I put up the link in the chat room in a while. What he said, what he observed, was that he said something in that TED talk that really hit me, is that teachers during that time, for them there were only two kinds of syllabus. The one that was in the, there was only two kinds of knowledge that needed to be imparted. The one that was for the students for their examinations, and the one that was simply out of the syllabus. I believe that that is now really changing, because teachers are sort of getting away from directly imparting that textbook education to encouraging students to look out for answers themselves, which is leading to more independent leaders of tomorrow who will be able to come up with solutions on their own.
Beautiful, absolutely beautiful. So yes, definitely.
Meenakshi, I just want to continue the talk of Padam. It was a nice tweet relating to the Padam's wordings of Pooja Sachdeva on your Twitter handle. The use of technology has grown exponentially over a few years and has changed almost all sectors of human life, including education. It has made life easy, effective, and is now becoming accessible for everyone to use and innovate. Why I quoted this tweet, because just now Padam said that earlier teachers had only a syllabus to teach in the class, had a fixed curriculum to teach in the class. Now there is a different varieties which can be taught, because technology is making it easier for us to access different kind of content, different type of things to teach in the class, in innovative ideas, in different creative ideas, different type of pedagogies to be used in the classes, different type of methods to be used in the classes. But I always say that technology has that credit to be given, that we have life of more ease if we talk about the accessibility of the content, accessibility of the methodologies. So absolutely I agree with Padam that there are different things which have been changed, which are still changing just using the technology. But at the same time, different type of interrelationship skills, different skills are being hampered at times, what I feel, between the colleagues, between the teachers, or between the teachers and the students also. What I feel, that might be my observation, I might be mistaken in the observation, but yes, what I felt, I quoted. I just want to add on one thing more. In the very beginning, we started with STEM, that is STEM. Then we came back to STEAM, that was STEAM. Now we came back to STREAM, STREAM. So we have been improvising ourselves also from the technology. STEM, that is STEM, was completely based on technology. Now STREAM is additionally also, if you have read up the National Education Policies draft, it is talking more majorly about the liberal education. If you have read the draft of NPE 2019, it is talking more and more about the liberal education. Why it is not talking about the technology much? because we have seen that technology cannot build that interpersonal relationship skills. I just read the tweet of Michael Collins. Michael Collins, you must have heard the name of him. He's a very great scientist, and 50 years ago he landed on the moon. He did not land on the moon, but he was a part of that team of the scientists with Neil Armstrong 50 years ago. So I just read his wordings that now the time has come for to convert STEM into STEAM, not STEAM. He is talking about STEEM, means STE is for effective communication. So effective communication can be done with the words also, not using the technology. So I feel that technology is not everywhere used in the teaching, in the education sector specifically, but yes, it is playing a major and the vital role in our system. Back to you.
STEAM, STEM, STREAM, or SHTEAM for that matter, what we do here is everywhere things are changing. So that's the bright spot out there. Also, what I would want to bring to notice once again, consolidating the conversations on this, but I think before I do that, Mrs. Berman, did you have something to add there?
Yeah, actually, I just wanted to add something. In fact, taking off from what Ashish was just mentioning, is that when we talk about the changing environment that I see as a huge change over the years, is the relationship between the teacher and the child, the student. In India, I mean, I've seen it in many places. I'm sure many of us will agree. Over the years, the relationships have become so beautiful. There's such a beautiful connect now between a teacher and a student. And because of this environment in the classroom becoming, I think even technology has some role to play, because that connect naturally comes because children are so connected to technology. So when they see their teachers using technology, there's one common bonding point, you know, with them. So when teachers and students connect and the environment in the class becomes democratic, people are asking questions, there's interaction, there's so much more that happens that I think that the level of discussion and understanding of the child starts to change how time goes by. So I feel that this environment, this great change in a classroom environment in India has come, I think the number one change has been the change in the relationship between the teacher and the students. I see this as a beautiful change in classroom.
I think you've beautifully wrapped up this whole talk about the learning environment and also set stage, which says that the role of school leaders and educators has changed. I would put relationships in this bracket majorly, because the kind of relationships that we now have, we see between school leaders, educators, stakeholders, students, parents, I think has transformed 360 degree. Let's please hear your thoughts about it.
I'll just jump in on that one. I think I've just caught the tail end. I was actually quite taken by Priyanka's comments around, you know, that this isn't a technology conversation. But as a school leader myself, I recognise that the way that young people view their world, make sense of their world, and contribute purposefully to their world is fundamentally impacted by the use of technology. And so I really liked what Priyanka sort of touched on around leveraging technology to amplify student voice and choice. And I liked the way that she touched on its potential to build relationships, often with those students who maybe were the quiet, thoughtful students who in the past haven't had a voice, who haven't had teacher time, and now that they have greater teacher time. When I think about the implications for school leadership, let's be honest, I've been one. It's got to start with the school leader. A innovative classroom teacher can only do so much. It requires for whole system change, for improvement to happen at scale, what school leaders and system leaders know and think about the potential of new approaches, regardless of whether it involves technology or not, is critical. And just on that comment, one of the things that shifted over the last 10 to 15 years isn't just we have lots of technology and we're being encouraged to use it. What we know about learning itself has changed over the last 15 years. So as a profession of professional educators, we've seen the rise of positive psychology. We've seen the contributions that neuroscience is providing back to the profession around what is happening around motivation, around cognition, and around attention. So one thing we need to keep in mind when we're talking about changes in the teaching and learning landscape from a school leadership point of view is that it's not just about technology distracting or providing opportunities. It's what we know scientifically about the process of learning and the art of teaching has changed also. And for the better, we're much more informed. Back to you.
Yes, I think it is beautiful to see how education has transformed. Shweta Agarwal had tweeted that they are the school leaders. And in fact, the entire fraternity is more approachable and their actions and character give motivation to both students and teachers. And a true school leader brings all the knowledge of the world to the students and educators' doorsteps. So I think, yes, and I would give a shout out to Mrs. Dhillon here because she's done exactly that in her school. I think Dr. Winnie had already mentioned about her in the beginning, but I think the school and the school leadership and the whole team is a role model for us to see and to talk about.
Can I mention about one or two more things that I feel have changed?
Absolutely.
Actually, I just want to mention about two different things which have had a very indirect impact in the classrooms. One, I think, is also in India, the role of the parents, if you really give a deep thought to it, I think has changed tremendously. There was a time when parents were very disconnected or were not so concerned, maybe because over the years, India is also, as a whole, emerging as a slightly more educated country, which happens in every developing country. So the parents were very disconnected with what's happening. Even the schools were not very welcoming of any suggestions or any feedback from the parents. Today, a parent is very, very connected to what's going on with the child in the classroom and in the school per se, at large. So what happens is, that when the parent is connected to the teacher and the teacher is very welcoming of parents' feedback and suggestion, this also forces a teacher to be a little bit up to date, find out about the individual needs of children, work really, really hard, and connect with the child to make a difference to a child in the classroom. So I think a parent has had a great, great impact in what's really changing behind in our classrooms. The other thing I want to mention about is the role of the promoters. You mentioned it a little in the beginning. I think promoters' roles have changed a lot. They are today ready to invest in their teachers. The amount of investment in continuous professional development that the schools have begun to put in, the kind of exposure, the kind of travel that is happening of all our educators, has brought back a lot of change and a variety of different learning styles and thoughts into the classrooms in India. So I see these two as great indirect impacts into the changing scenario of classrooms in India.
Fantastic. I think you've put a very good tab on the way the stakeholders have opened up their minds. We see conferences happening, I think, every week, every month, where we have rich conversations around these kind of, adoption of, I would again go beyond technology or, away from technology to say just the practices, just what's happening, what's the thought process that's in the air. So they just gather that, bring it back. Shweta said that, they bring it to our doorsteps to say, here you are, this is what is happening around you. Why don't you take it into your classroom? So that certainly is a big change. Any other thoughts here, please?
Meenakshi,
go ahead, Doctor.
Please go ahead. Please go ahead.
Okay. So I wanted to share that we find greater evidence of schools now looking at and classrooms looking out for more meaningful ways of engaging with student community, we see appetite for game-based learning. On one hand, though, there was this issue raised for addiction and students spending a lot of time on technologies, but we are also seeing that students are looking out for meaningful ways of engagement and learning things in a new manner, which is unconventional. So we have seen a lot of traction for game-based learning approaches through Minecraft, and also seen a lot of traction for artificial intelligence led learning opportunities as well. As there's a shift that's happening in the entire economy per se, in terms of industry embracing artificial intelligence to solve problems that matter to the countries. So whether it's about financial services, citizenship services, or for example, medical procedures or in healthcare, making healthcare more affordable. And since industry is making that shift, we are seeing that there is hunger and appetite in the learners as well to embrace these technologies. So for instance, the CBSE board has given an option to embrace artificial intelligence as the sixth subject in the schools. And there are hundreds of schools that have opted in for that. And I think in a systematic manner, next year, we will see more of it. And industry is coming forward to support these interventions. So from a Microsoft perspective, we would be adopting about 500 schools, CBSE schools in the country, and will be driving training of educators and student communities on artificial intelligence in the next few months.
Yeah, that's great. I'll just share another quick one from a leadership point of view, which was, I think, the original question. I've shared a link to a YouTube clip in the chat box. It's a really interesting story that was shared last week at a huge event in Las Vegas that Microsoft runs called Ready. And it shows Dr. David Kellerman, who's a lecturer in the School of Engineering at the University of New South Wales, and how he has completely changed, enhanced the experience of his students. He's transformed the classrooms, he's transformed the learning experiences, he's built a community of learners, and this is all using a combination of AI and also a collaborative platform that we're using right now, which is Microsoft Teams. So it's this really interesting real world example of how an inspired, passionate leader who understands the potential and the pitfalls of technology, who realizes that transformation isn't a digital transformation. This is a human transformation. It involves the work of humans who engage with humans in a social and emotional context, which is school. Which we know that school is an emotional roller coaster. Therefore, any transformation to be successful must be a human transformation.
Yeah.
Thank you,
Mo. May I add in?
Sorry.
So, getting away from technology and changes in teaching methods here, I believe that the basic kind of interaction that is happening between educators and learners has changed a lot in the last 5 years or so. Students sort of have this instinctive trust on their teachers today, which is something which is sometimes having more confidence in them than they have in their co-learners. It's actually been a long time since I've talked to some of my own classmates, but I'm still in good touch with my teachers. And the teachers are just more approachable now. They're easy to approach with their queries, with any questions that you have, with anything you want to learn out of the curriculum. And I believe that it's this fundamental sense of trust that is truly the key factor of how the basic relationship between a student and teacher has evolved in the last few years or so. Yeah, that's it for me.
So I just wanted to basically take off from where Padam ended. I think Ashish mentioned about the new education policy. And I was just thinking about, this is more of a prediction, I mean, this is the way I see after I've gone through the whole education policy, and many of us have in this sector. What I really see as a huge change that is, again, further going to come is, I think the quality of people coming into teaching is going to go in for a huge shift, because the new education policy number of times has spoken and reiterated about respect for the teachers because of the kind of contribution the teaching fraternity has brought into to the country and the change that has happened in the country. And they're talking about, you know, better people coming in. And the most important thing is that teacher training is going to go in for a lot of change. So just to cut a very long talk very short is, people have realized that the biggest and the most important unit in any school is the teacher in the classroom. And our investment and our respect to a teacher, and in terms of, you know, whether it's an investment in terms of teaching them, sending them for professional development, which you already mentioned, and their coming back and making a difference in the classroom is going to be the biggest investment that has happened, and it is only going to change because the new education policy is now going to force us to do more and more, and better people are going to come into the education sector. I see that as a great paradigm shift, and I see that as absolutely, it's like a silver lining for the education sector in India.
I think that also creates a lot of hope and actually encourage people to really take up this profession more seriously here in India. So yes, fantastic. I'm going to pause here because our attendees here have been very patient. They've been posting their comments beautifully in the chat window. So I'm going to ask Duhita if there is any particular comment here on the Teams or on Twitter that needs our attention, or if there is any question or a query. Duhita, if there's anything that we can help you with.
Thank you so much, Meenakshi. Good evening, everyone. So I see a question, not a question, but a nice comment by Kamal Preet, and Mark has responded to it very nicely. I think we also need to reflect on the other side. Is technology just an enabler? It has connected continents, yet widened the distance inside our homes. It has given a voice to the voiceless, yet we see overstimulation and an increase in reported ADHD inside classes. So I think we really need to listen to this or read this insight and deep thinking. So I think Mark has replied, but I would request Mark to share his thoughts on the same, and anyone else also, please.
Yeah, this is a massive topic across the globe, and every system, every parent group, every educator group I work with raises very valid concerns around young people's engagement with screens. And on one hand, you could have a conversation which is around the difference between quality time and quantity time. And it could be argued that any obsessive focus on any activity that displaces something else is probably unhealthy, and that what we seek for our young people is to make informed choices and to learn to self-regulate and also be aware of what these technologies are doing and not doing for them. So I always come back to the critical role we've seen in the last, the last 4 or 5 years, this rising focus around developing emotional intelligence with our young people. Because with emotional intelligence, which means that you are able to recognize, understand, label, express, and regulate. This comes from the Yale Center for Emotional Intelligence's RULER approach. Recognize, understand, label, express, and regulate yourself. That applies to the use of technology. Sometimes the best thing to do is to close that device. Sometimes the best learning experience is to go as a group outside and engage in the real world, engage with the community. Technology's greatest potential is to help humanize the learning process, not just to digitize content. And this comes back to the critical role of teachers and school leaders in being able to lever the potential for technology to do good, to be good, and to explore more.
I think it's beautifully put out there, and as much as I would have liked.
I would like to add something.
Go ahead, please.
Excuse me. I would like to add something more here. Madam Dillo also mentioned about something about technology. So I would relate that query with the message of Madam Dillo. She mentioned that the problem in the use of the technology in education lies in the mind of us, perhaps the elders. So I am emphasizing on the word elders, because I am relating the word elders with the parents, with the family members, with our elders in the family. So students or the maybe children love and are happy using technology for learning, not only in the classrooms, but in the families also. So just because of that, the elders are feeling uncomfortable or they are not very, very tech savvy to use the technology. So sometimes it is being observed that the elders in our families are leaving the children aside or separate, that you go and use the technology, just use the technology and study using a different kind of apps, different type of online resource material of the study content. So why we are leaving the children aside or separate from them? Because they might be feeling uncomfortable to use the technology. So if we know how to use the technology well, it is always a boon for us, because it makes our learning, I'm not talking about the study part only, I'm talking about the learning, because we all are the learners, whether the parents, whether we the students, all are the learners. So I'm just talking about everyone, because if we use the technology well, that can always be very creative, very joyful. So the family members can always learn together. So there is no problem in using the technology at home also, because the elders, what Madam Dillo rightly mentioned, that as elders, if we are feeling uncomfortable to use it, that is the only reason what I feel that the family members, parents, our children are going far away from each other. Back to you.
Thank you. I think I'm once again going to drift this whole discussion from becoming a debate about technology to bringing, you know, the changes in education. I had very carefully placed the technology as the last thought for the day, but I guess technology is something that you cannot ignore right now. Therefore, all the, everywhere that we are talking about, the whole ecosystem is actually revolving around the talks about technology, but there are much changes that have happened in the attitudes of learners, of educators, and of the entire ecosystem for that matter. The fourth thought.
Sorry, actually, I would just again interrupt you for apologies. Not just sure. I want to add, because we have been talking about the technology and we have been talking about the pros and the cons of using the technology in the classroom as well as in the family as well as at home. Because just if you read thoroughly the National Education Policy's draft, so it is also talking about more on liberal education, what I have been quoting in our talk today. So why are they talking about the liberal art education? Because they have also understood that we have embraced very nicely the technology in our families or in the classrooms. So now is the need of the R to initiate different type of interpersonal relationship skills, to change the assessment system also. If you really read the draft of the National Education Policy, it is very nicely talking about to change the assessment pattern. The education policy makers are also not themselves satisfied with our assessment policy, assessment system, what we are using. However, we have been doing away with the CCE pattern. However, we have come up with the board examinations back to us, but still assessment system needs a major change in itself. So if you read the NEP, it is also talking about the major change in the assessment system also.
You've, I think, set the ground for my next topic, which is changing face of assessment in the classroom. But I would really urge for this conversation So let's see if assessment has really changed keeping technology out of the, you know, for now, because the next thought is about technology. Let's talk about, apart from technology, how has the pace of assessment changed and has it really changed? And I would urge Padam to please speak first and Dr. Vinny to, you know, then go next. And if we can then, you know, have some more thoughts out here. Padam, let's hear from you. Has assessment really changed for the student in the classroom?
I'd say it's only become more difficult now because sort of there's this rigorous schedule of examinations happening weekly that do not leave students with a lot of time to devote to other things. Students, especially in the later years of high school, like 11th and 12th, do not get to follow their passion, do not get to devote as much time into what they really love because they have to study for these examinations. If you think about it, the major professions that we have in India are basically engineering or say becoming a doctor. These require tests, taking up admission tests such as JEE and NEET. These tests themselves require you to study for them in a separate institution. Those institutions themselves require you to take up separate coaching so that you're able to get into those institutions. That's how the examination system in India is right now. And that, I believe, is truly something that needs to be worked upon. Sort of more as we need to get away from these explicit weekly examinations and get into a system in which students are tested on what knowledge is actually required for what they want to do become honest in life, rather than sort of sticking to what is, rather than telling up to mug up what is the content, what is the text in their books.
Honest, I love this bold voice from a student about assessment because we certainly need to hear their voice, and I think you brought in a very good perspective out there. Dr. Vinny, what would...
Meenakshi, what Padam has just mentioned about the separate coaching for the NEET, for the medical examination, for the engineering preparations. So I'm just coming back again to the National Education Policy. Why I'm talking again and again about the National Education Policy? Because after a long, we are going to change our education pattern because it is again talking about the great achievement what we have been talking in the past years. So it is also mentioning in the education policy that we are still wanting to change the assessment system. We also want to change the things which are happening in the classroom so that such kind of things like NEET preparations for the engineering preparations cannot happen separately out of the classroom. So that kind of talking is also being discussed in the National Education Policy. So we are very hopeful about the National Education Policy which is to be coming.
I would like Vinny to speak first since you wanted to speak, and then I'd like to put in my perspective on this. Vinny, please go ahead.
Sure, thank you, Amrita. So I would like to say that assessment is an area that really requires a lot of attention because to a large extent, it will also contribute to the change that we want to bring in the education system. In K-12, I completely echo the sentiments of expressed by Padam that still assessments are very much focused towards rote learning and achieving on the scale of 10. We see that admissions in the Delhi University, the gap is 99.9 to 99, achieving 99% marks. And it's all oriented towards getting admission in one of the good engineering colleges or a good medical college or becoming a chartered accountant. So it's all towards leaning towards fewer professions. Yes, there is a wave of change coming in, but still it's very much exam oriented system of learning and teaching and assessment as well. In higher education, it varies. I mean, if you look at engineering institutions, most of them, there is still a lot of challenge because it's still pretty much exam-oriented learning and teaching, and assessments are like, they might be midterm assessments or end-term assessments, but plagiarism is a very big challenge in the classrooms. However, there are few innovative universities and few international affiliated universities, or I would say in K-12 as well, where schools are more open to experimentation and tinkering with newer ways of assessment, continuous assessments, learning outcomes-based assessments, and giving more autonomy to students to tinker with on multiple projects and learn much beyond from an examination perspective. But it is an area that requires major reforms and rethink. Lessons from global universities do indicate that teach less, encourage the building of 21st century skills in your assessment pattern, and through smaller level of or lesser amount of teaching in the classroom, give more autonomy to students to work on hands-on projects that leads to richer learning outcomes.
I think before we move forward, may I please take a minute to thank Mark for being here. Thank you so very much. We completely understand that you do have your kickboxing class waiting for you. Your presence here was absolutely valuable. And I think that we all thank you so much for being here. And I hope you've enjoyed this session as much as we've enjoyed it with you. Very mindful of the time that we've run out, but I think there are such rich conversations that are going on. I wouldn't want to stop here. So yes, please, the floor is all yours, Mrs. Berman.
Yeah, so I pretty much agree, and in fact echo the thoughts of Vinny, and in fact Padam, because Padam spoke about higher education entrances, etc., etc. So I just want to add something, because I think these are the few things that we've been trying in our own systems. There are, because of admissions, whether it's Delhi University or it's engineering or it's medical, it's all absolutely skewed towards high marks and high coaching, etc. So those things also go on in all schools. But we have some amount of freedom, at least till it comes to class 8, And even in class 9, for that matter, we've been doing a lot of, we really haven't dropped CCE completely, like the way people kind of just dropped it CBSE said no to it. Because we saw inherent strengths in the continuous assessment pattern. So we have been using a lot of our informal methods of assessment. And I think they've really paid, because we do look into learning outcomes rather than just rote learning, and we do think about clarity of concept, of telling children where they went wrong, etc. So continuous assessment has been going on. I think one major shift that we've made is talking to children about alternate careers, which Vinny kind of mentioned. We have a lot of children who have not necessarily gone in for medicine or engineering as a course. And therefore, children have not really been only hassled about marks. Once we gave them this assurance that even if you're not top of the line with your marks, you still have a good future. So don't get so hassled. Look into your basic concept clarity and follow your dreams. If you have been great at dancing, singing, etc., just follow that. Now, that has made a child much, much lighter, and assessments have completely changed in a number of ways in our schools. So children have actually got confidence in themselves. Their assessments have been informal. They've understood, they've been successful in life, and they all have not necessarily become doctors and engineers, but they've really been doing well. So I think it's more a focus on alternate careers, which is also going to shift focus when it comes to assessments in schools.
True, very true. I think the whole sentiment around assessments has been voiced absolutely aptly. And we have had a Prajita Rally who wrote that assessments may be changing in some systems. The importance of formative assessment may also be getting actualized. But at the end of the day, nothing moves out without marks. With everyone getting about 96 to 100%, the race becomes more ugly and harsh unless we resolve that. But I think I'm going to leave that thought to ponder upon rather than debate, because it's important and needs its own place to really ponder upon. The last but not the least, one of the most talked about thought is that the use of technology in learning has transformed the mundane classroom environment. I think we've talked enough about this. Yet I'm going to leave the floor open for discussion, for any thoughts that we have around this. I'm very mindful that we have run 10 minutes over time, but I think good conversations just cannot stop. So if you have to leave to go somewhere, we completely understand. And thank you for being here. But if you still want to be around, please be around. We are here for some time discussing this. Thank you. Yes, Padam, I think you have something to say there.
Yeah, so we've already talked a lot about this, I believe. So just summing up in a few words, I believe that with coming of technology in the classrooms, we're sort of shifting towards more of practical knowledge rather than theoretical, which is truly something that the student enjoys. And we get a better grasp at things if we're getting to see it through that practical knowledge rather than getting to make a sense, rather than making sense of it through on our own from the textbooks. Yeah, but then again, the issue that we've talked about through all this chat is that there should be a balance maintained between how much technology should be used. And that is something that I think all of us are currently working on, and it'll certainly get better with time. Yeah, that's it for me.
I'd like to put my parting thoughts on technology since you just left the floor open before I leave. Technology is here to stay. The sooner we accept it, the better it is. It's not only here to stay, it's only going to be more a part of our lives, because there have been some great innovations and great inventions when it comes to technology. So I think the challenge lies more with teachers, with all of us as educators, as to decide how much is the right amount that we need to put into our classrooms, how much we can give other challenges. So to children, so that they, they kind of, at the same time, those basic things, not being connected with each other, not becoming a slave or an addict to screen time and technology. I think once we teach all these little cyber hygienes to our children and we teach them how to deal with technology, I think it's a beautiful thing. It's going to remain. We might as well accept it and teach our children in the classroom how to. I don't think I can imagine my life or my children's life without this.
Thank you, Amrita. I think that is absolutely right and absolutely valuable.
Meenakshi, I just want to sum up my point also. Because sure. I always find a school leader, maybe the principal or any other, because CBSE is also calling them as a pedagogical leaders. That is the right word, what I also feel. Because why we are calling them as a pedagogical leaders? Because they are the facilitators, they are the motivators, they are the source of inspiration. They have to think for the growth of the staff. Growth does not mean in the sense of the monetary benefit, in the manner of the growth, maybe for the kind of the content related, maybe kind of the different type of skill-based learning. So different type of well-being of the staff that the pedagogical leaders has to think on. They have to set the goals of the school, because until unless they have a goal, the teachers and the students, nobody can move ahead. They should have a clear vision and the mission of the school. They should have a good values to be developed in the schools, to develop a good environment among the learners, to develop the quality education there, cultivating leadership, managing people, data, processes. They just not have to impart the knowledge, but develop 21st century skills among the learners in the schools. So I feel that pedagogical leaders have a major responsibility on their shoulders to go ahead, to teach the way, to show the way to their teachers, to their staff members, to the students as well.
Totally resonate your thoughts out there. But I would like to wrap up this whole session by putting forward that yes, there has been a positive change in education systems in India, and we are progressing. There has been a significant shift, though there might be a long way to go, but I think change is something that has to keep happening. You cannot stop changing and evolving and becoming better at what we are. So thank you so very much for your expertise, Mrs. Burman, Dr. Mittal, Padam. Thank you so very much, Vinny.
Thank you so much,
Mark. Sure. I think this is a great platform. A great platform for sharing thoughts. We had 40 plus educators joining us using Teams, and about an equal or even more number of teachers right on Twitter with us today. We will be consolidating all these thoughts and sharing with you all. Thank you all for your valuable time and patience. And I think we should meet often to exchange thoughts. Thank you so very much on that note. We will be sharing a recording of this session with you shortly. So thank you for coming, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for having us.